During the 1930s, a terrible drought struck Texas and the Great Plains. This one was different from any drought in the past. It triggered a decade-long series of dust storms that became known as the Dust Bowl. The causes of the Dust Bowl were both natural and man-made. Lack of rainfall made the ground that grew wheat, corn, and other valuable crops parched and cracked. Over-farming and outdated agricultural techniques eroded the once fertile topsoil and depleted the ground of its nutrients. In Texas, many dust storms were mild, but there were a few severe ones called black blizzards. Picture a snowstorm, but instead of fluffy snow falling from the sky, imagine dark, choking dust swirling all around.
The dust storms bring darkness at noon.
The worst of these black blizzards struck with a vengeance on April 14, 1935. It is often called Black Sunday by survivors, and the Texas Panhandle was the hardest hit area of the state. The storm carried the dust and topsoil so far that ships anchored 300 miles off the coast reported finding dust on their decks. Newspapers from across the country feverishly reported about Black Sunday, including Associated Press reporter Robert Geiger, who was credited with coining the phrase the Dust Bowl. As he wrote, three little words, achingly familiar on a Western farmer's tongue, rule life today in the Dust Bowl of the continent, if it rains. While Texas and the Great Plains faced the Dust Bowl, the rest of the country sank into the Great Depression following the stock market crash of 1929. With the livelihoods of most Texans tied to farming and living off the land, the prices for any and all crops dropped severely due to the Depression. Sonora Babb, a California journalist originally from Kansas, returned home to visit her mother and could not believe what had become of the plains and its downtrodden people. She reflected, "I saw them standing in line for the meat and potatoes of relief. Their stricken faces, one after another in the line, looked very much alike. As the soil that had once helped feed the nation turned to dust, many were forced to leave Texas in search of better farmland. Those who remained, however, received help from the federal government. The Civilian Conservation Corps was put in place to not only give people work, but also to try to conserve the soil and reverse the Dust Bowl. The CCC planted 200 million trees from Abilene, Texas, all the way to Canada. Another project called the Works Progress Administration, or WPA, employed millions of Texans on public projects. Most WPA jobs in Texas were in construction. Parks, swimming pools, bridges, highways were all built by hardworking Texans. Just as man-made and natural occurrences triggered the Dust Bowl, those same two forces helped end it. Rain began to fall more frequently and the temperatures cooled. Farmers updated and changed their farming techniques to keep the topsoil healthy and fertile. The Dust Bowl taught Texans many important lessons about the land and how the health of it affects their society, economy, and community.
A little short little video there, of course, on the Dust Bowl, which, of course, occurred at the same time when, of course, the Great Depression occurred, of course, in the 1920s. So anyway, I welcome you back, Course History 2023, Daniel Simon, Matt Rouge Community College. I hope you're having a great week out there. Pretty much. This week, of course, I'll be shifting from the 1920s to pretty much the 1930s, which didn't go so well. You know about that in American history. We go from this prosperous time we had to like this economic depression, which gripped the nation for close to a decade or more. So anyway, before I get started, of course, looks like we have, looks like Ross is out there again, of course, watching again like usual. Hey, Ross, hope you're having a great afternoon overall. So anybody else want to join us, of course, here's the link, of course, to StreamYard.com right here, this live stream, or of course, most of you, of course, can watch it later, recorded. Like I said, today's lecture, I'm going to get into, you know, and talk about the Great Depression. You know, the stock market crash occurs in 1920, one of the worst in American history. Again, how much was it? $30 billion wiped out in a couple of days, just like that, in stock. So I'll talk about that. I'll talk about how under Herbert Hoover, they just don't know what to do. Herbert Hoover is kind of lost as president, of course, during that time. There's a lot of butt of jokes, of course, about Hoover. You may have heard of Hooverism and things like that from the time. And if you have any comments, questions about this lecture or any lecture, let me know, of course, on my YouTube channel or, of course, during the live stream. If you've got a question, let me know more or less. I could kind of just quickly answer that for you. So anyway, like I said, of course, we'll be moving on today to, you know, talk about the Great Depression. By the way, that picture right there on the left, we kind of blow that up, is one of the most famous pictures ever taken during the Great Depression. I think his name is Dorothea Lange, I think is her name. She, of course, took a lot of pictures of the Depression era. And I think that's kind of a mark of, you know, why they call it a depression, you know, because people are so depressed, you know, because the economy is so bad, you know. So anyway, before I get going, of course, y'all do have assignments out right now. I think you just got one major assignment I know you'll have right now, which is the first exam. So that's out right now. So that'll be due. I think you got till like next week, I think, to wrap it up. I think I've got like a bunch of days left on it. I know you've got on that. But I think there was another assignment. I got it closed, I think, I want to say yesterday, I believe it was. So that's basically what's pretty much coming up next that's due. And believe it or not, I think after the spring break, which starts Friday into next week, I think when we come back, we'll have another exam. Is that one top of another one? I know it's crazy, but kind of running out of weeks, I guess, to give exams and quizzes and all that. So, yeah, it's the only thing I hate about that. We get near the end and start running out of time and all that. All right. So anyway, like I said, I'm going to, of course, talk about the Great Depression. I think we're up to talking about, I think, the fact that the stock market crashed, you know, at the end of the 1920s, the so-called Roaring 20s, you know, came to an end at that time. And so it's like, you know, that's really the main reason. That's not the only reason, but it's like obviously the main thing that really, you know, started the whole Great Depression was the stock market crashing in 1929. Apparently, it would cause the severe depression in the country. And I think for like the first year or two, like I think going back to, I want to say 1927, 28, they kind of realized that the bull market, which I guess was real popular at the time of the 20s, was kind of coming to an end. It was starting to kind of end at that point overall. What happened was they had two really bad days in 1 week in the stock market, which I'll put it on the screen here, October 24th and October 29th, like back to back within like less than a week, which were called Black Thursday, Black Tuesday, back and forth. In those 2 days, the stock market, like they lost like something like 30 billion shares in less than a week. So a lot of people lost all their money, not just individuals, but, you know, business corporations and so on lost a lot of money. And they called it later different names. The people call it the Great Crash, the Crash of 29. You had cases where a lot of investors basically lost all their money, lost everything. You even had people that killed themselves. They jumped off buildings. They shot themselves because it was that bad. You can see all the people kind of gathering, I think, when right there in that picture on the bottom right, where people panicked, I guess, after, you know, the stock market crashed, and you have all these people selling and selling and selling and selling, you know, and it just caused the whole economy to eventually crash. What ends up happening, it reverberates, you know, and starts affecting the economy after that. And so you get a deal where the stock market causes the closure of businesses. So a lot of businesses close in the country. Banks close. I think they're saying 200-300 banks were closed in a week after that. Everybody lost all their money. It's crazy about that. Massive unemployment in the United States, of course, that followed. Thousands lost their jobs, businesses. They lost their farmland. Bank savings. People lost $3.2 billion in money and savings after that. Look at that. Unemployment, 1930, by that time, 7 million people unemployed. 1932, 12 million people unemployed. So that's 25% unemployment, 1932, which, by the way, was the peak of basically the Great Depression. It's kind of like now, like what happened after COVID, you know, the people that got laid off, you know, because they closed everything down. It was kind of like that in comparison with that. Farm commodities collapsed, too. That was another thing that happened. So a lot of the farmers suffered because of it. What was that thing I was looking at statistic-wise? But the amount of, like, money that farmers got, what was it? I forget exactly. $2.25 a bushel during World War I, if you, like, for wheat, was how much they could get, which was pretty good for back then. Dropped to $1 a bushel, just to give you an idea of how bad things crashed for farmers in general. Of course, a lot of the farmers lost their homes. They lost their farms, you know, afterwards. And then, of course, on top of that, you had, I'll get to it later, we had the Dust Bowl, of course, that occurred at the same time, where we had this severe drought. We had all those dust storms that of course, occurred in the Midwest, like around Oklahoma, Kansas, in that areas. So pretty awful what happened, of course, in the 1920s after the so-called stock market crash that occurred. There's all kinds of causes of why the stock market crashed and, of course, why the Great Depression, you know, happened. You could you know, go through numerous things on what, you know, caused the stock market crash to eventually occur. I'll kind of go through them and kind of talk about all the different causes of, there's like, I think 10 of them. I think you go through a list of things that likely could have caused it right there. Yeah, excessive borrowing. That's one thing I think they talk about. It's one thing that definitely caused, you know, the stock market crash as well. And even like with stock, I don't know if you ever know, there's a term called buying on margin that they had, where basically the stock market was so popular that basically it became this inflated bubble where everybody was buying stock in it. There's a very famous story I like to sometimes tell, it's true. Joseph P. Kennedy, you may have heard of him, the Kennedys, they're very wealthy and all that. One day he was getting his shoe shine from a shoe shine boy. The boy was telling him what stock to buy. And so Joseph Kennedy was saying, hell, I got to get out of the stock market and sell. If some shoe shine boy wants to buy stock or knows about stock, it's too popular. And so he actually sold all of his stock. That's why the Kennedys were wealthy later, you know, because they sold out before, you know, everybody lost all their money. So, people actually literally would put 10% down on like buying stock and then pay off the rest in credit. They called it buying on margin, I think is what they called it, basically. And so you have that. Also, laissez-faire economics was another issue. Like we talked about how, you know, under Calvin Coolidge, they just didn't want to do too much regulation. So no regulations by the federal government. That's another thing, of course, that caused it. High tariffs. That's another thing, I think, caused it also as well. And when they, Hoover's in power, they actually keep raising them, which is bad. I'll get to that Smoot-Hawley tariff, but they actually raise them even more, thinking that'll help it. And I think it did worse because of that. Uneven distribution of income in the United States is also be considered. Some people blame the gold standard. There's another reason why that also happened. I mean, they all couldn't decide what they should have, gold standard, silver standard, or really bimetallism, a mixture of the two. Influence of supply and demand. That's another thing they think caused it. There was just too much overproduction of everything, you know, whether it be cars or radios or whatever was being made. They were just making too much and people weren't buying it. Not enough money in circulation. They talk about that. Also another one as being another one that may have caused also the stock market to crash. So like I said, it's got numerous causes. The stock market. I think still they're not sure what actually caused the Great Depression, you know, but it's going to last 11 years, you know, go on to like 1939, 1940. And really they talk about the New Deal that kind of helps to alleviate it, but they think that it really didn't end until World War II came in with the production of like war, you know, munitions and things like that. that helped propel the economy, which eventually improved the state after that. Now, of course, go back and talk about also Herbert Hoover a little bit. Where Herbert Hoover is, I don't know if we got a picture of Hoover or not, but Hoover, he got blamed a lot for the Great Depression. That's one thing that's very famous about that. Yeah, he was blamed for it, if you know about it. And he was president at the time. And so he became the butt of jokes about the Great Depression, about how bad it was. Of course, most of it starts under his, you know, when he's in power, because Hoover's president from 1920 to 1933. And he did little, by the way, to alleviate, you know, the Great Depression. I almost became like a hermit in the White House. And I think he was going to try a few other things later, but it doesn't really work too well, I think, initially, until maybe FDR comes in a little later. And the term Hooverism was used a lot for like all kinds of things. I think I've got a few slides on that talking about Hooverism. I could find where it is. There's the Hooverism thing. It's somewhere in there. Somewhere, yeah, there's Hooverville's. Of course, the Hooverville was one of the most famous things they talk about, which was part of the, you know, Great Depression, where he had all these shanty towns or homeless towns that were created throughout the United States. And people would live in these homes that were kind of made from any kind of scrap type metal or anything they could use to basically build something. And I had some pictures of some of the shanty towns. Like, yeah, there's some right here of some shanty towns. So they have these all throughout the United States, not just in the Midwest, because of, you know, what happened with the Dust Bowl and all that. But hundreds of thousands may have lived in these types of homes that, of course, got named for him over time. And they made fun of all kinds of things about Hoover. You had your, if you take your pocket, you know, I mean, you turned it inside out, it would become what they call a Hoover flag. They talked about that Hoover flag. We don't have any money. People eating instead of eating a hog or a pig, eat armadillos or something like that. They call it a Hoover hog or something like that. Yeah, Hoovervilles. That's right. Yeah, right. Hoovervilles. Exactly. That's what we're talking about. So that's what you're looking at. And that's what they, of course, named it after him. So they blamed him for, you know, the Great Depression. And so that's basically what happened across the country. It got so bad, you know, he had hobos that would, you know, ride the trains, if you know about that, across the country as migrants, you know, looking for jobs. Many of them lived in boxcars. You ever heard of that country musician named Boxcar Willie? I believe in his early life, he was actually a hobo. They were also called bums. Tramps, of course, during the Great Depression. I think my mom said that later on, like she remembers when she was a kid that they'd have like, you know, these hobos that would come by and she would like leave them food out or something like that to kind of help them out, things like that. So yeah, the Great Depression, that was of course something that was very famous with the Hoovervilles, the hobos. Of course, they had the famous Dust Bowl. Of course, they were talking about in the video that happened, of course, in the United States, which was, like I said, a severe drought that gripped the Great Plains, which there's been kind of been some debates about what actually caused, the so-called Dust Bowl that occurred. It mostly happened in states like Nebraska, Oklahoma, Kansas. They think maybe overgrazing of cattle, maybe like over, growing crops too much may have also caused it to also happen, where the topsoil kind of blew away. And the next thing you know, you had all these dust storms that would occur, you know, throughout the Midwest, where it peaked like around, I want to say 1934, where I think maybe the worst you can see there. It's like one storm in 34 picked up millions of tons of dust from the plains, and it actually carried all the way to the East Coast. That's amazing about that. In that little video, they talked about the whole so-called black blizzards, right? Were these massive dust storms that would black out the sky where you couldn't see anything. And so it destroyed their livelihood. They couldn't make any money, you know, off of farming. And so a lot of them fled as migrants. And so many of them ended up, if you know about this, going to California, so-called Okies, or the Playa of the Okies and all that. Okies, the Arkies, I think they got all kinds of nicknames, but they called them. A lot of them kind of rode down the highway, you know, in these dilapidated, you know, automobiles. And I've seen some where they even have, like, you know, they don't have an engine. If they're being pulled by animals or something, like horses or something, something crazy like that. You probably heard of John Steinbeck, who wrote the famous book, Grapes of Wrath. It's a very well-known book. They've made movies out of it, too. And it dramatizes, you know, the plight of the Okies as they fled westward to California and all that. But if you study about the Okies, they really, when they got to California, they realized that things weren't exactly great out there either. Wasn't exactly paradise, if you know about that. And there's a famous folk singer I kind of talk about, I'll kind of mention. There's the Grapes of Wrath, which was published in 1939. Probably Steinbeck's best book that he ever published. He's got a bunch of other books, Of Mice and Men, Cannery Row. May have heard of that too, also as well. You may have heard of Woody Guthrie. He's a famous folk singer who's real big from that time period during the Great Depression. He lived also as a hobo as well, kind of migrating across the United States, like riding on freight cars, you know, box cars also as well. Played and recorded a lot of songs later, mostly about America and the plight of the poor peoples of the country. You know about Guthrie, he's very famous for his song, This Land Is Your Land, which became kind of like an American anthem. And Guthrie, I don't know if you know, he was a socialist. He's famous for that guitar that has like that little sticker on it that says, this machine kills fascists. And I think he wrote the song, This Land Is Your Land, because he hated the song, God Bless America, and all that. He wanted to replace that song instead, which I think Irving Berlin was the one who wrote that song originally, God Bless America. Some people don't like it, by the way. He had a lot of songs about, you know, the plight of the Okies as they went westward. I do have this song here I like to play sometimes, which is really about that, which is about the plight of the Okies and the Dust Bowl as they went westward. So let me go ahead and play it real quick for you. It's called Do Re Mi, and it's by Woody Guthrie. So anyway, that's, of course, that famous song by, of course, Woody Guthrie, which really kind of sums up the fact that if you go to California, if you don't have any money, well, you're just as bad as you were before you go there. So that's kind of like the Dust Bowl that kind of happened about the same time, of course, as the Great Depression, of course, was going on. I wanted to also talk about, which is true, you know, later, especially in the late 20s, 1930s, you had all these bank robbers that they had, you know, during the Great Depression that you always hear about, like John Dillinger. He was considered one of the most famous of the, you know, famous Great Depression bank robbers up in the north. I think his peak was like 1932 before he was gunned down in Chicago. He had that going on as well. So, yeah, obviously the Great Depression spawned a lot of criminals who a lot of people thought were like Robin Hoods, robbing from the banks, maybe to give to the poor, more like themselves. But, all kinds. Yeah, you know, John Dillinger, Bonnie and Clyde, Machine Gun Kelly, Babyface Nelson, Barker Gang. All these people, of course, were very famous, you know, during the Great Depression. Of course, in Louisiana, you know, we know more about Bonnie and Clyde because they were both killed actually in northern Louisiana in 1934. They were famous for, of course, you know, robbing a lot of banks, and they committed numerous murders, killed nine police officers, you can see there, and committing a lot of the robberies throughout America. So late 20s, early 1930s was like the peak period, really, of these kind of gangsters that they had, of course, that were running around, America at the time. Now, I want to get in next and talk a little bit about, of course, you know, Herbert Hoover does try to do some things, you know, to try and, you know, alleviate the Great Depression. That is something that is true about that. Of course, he does do some things. I know under him, they did begin to spend about $500 million to create more jobs in the country, so-called pump priming, where the government actually spent their own money, basically borrowing money to try and alleviate things in. So there are some things that they did try to do. I know Hoover is kind of blamed for this. I think what happened was they didn't do it soon enough. In fact, I think they waited to almost like 1932 to really do anything about it. Why was that? Well, Hoover had this idea, which I think I thought I talked about before. Maybe I didn't. But Hoover believed in something called rugged individualism, which was a term he coined. And he believed that basically the people should be able to succeed without outside help, you know, like saying from the government relying on it. A lot of people believe this still today, that, you know, if you rely too much on the government for help, you get too dependent as a person or whatever. And so that's part of why Hoover didn't want to do that. And Hoover was a self-made man. I think he was a millionaire. So that's basically their view about things. But it did lead to some, you know, projects which they tried to, hire people, to employ people. And I'll kind of go through some examples of some things they did do under Hoover in the 1930s. They had the Boulder Dam was constructed, if you know about that, on the Colorado River between 1931 to 36, later called, by the way, Hoover Dam, it's now called today. It's now, of course, built southwestern part of the United States. It, of course, was eventually built there to not just dam the Colorado River, which they would to control flood control, but it was also developed for hydroelectricity, which would be very important, by the way, later for cities like Las Vegas, you know, that are kind of nearby and all that, and other cities. So that's kind of going to be important. But the only problem with this was that, it employed people, which it did. But get this. It employed 3,000-something people, but 10 to 20,000 wanted jobs. That shows you how bad things are when you got that many people want to work, but that's all they got, you know. So that's the only problem with that. So it led to more things with Congress. Congress eventually in 1932 passed an act which is called the Emergency Relief and Construction Act, 1932. It's considered one of the first, by the way, major relief legislations passed to help people during the Great Depression. It would basically create jobs for people, construction projects, you know, which would, they say, put people to work, as an example. They also had the Reconstruction Finance Corporation was also created too in 1932. And it was actually this corporation they created to loan money to businesses, to keep businesses afloat, because after the Great Depression happened and the stock market crashed, thousands of people lost their jobs, lost their businesses. I forget how many were lost, like in the first year, but it was just thousands. And you can see they injected about $2 billion into the U.S. economy. It did help some things, but it obviously didn't do enough to help people out. I'll give you examples of some things they did do with some of these projects. Like it led, like that act itself, the one at the top, I was talking about this one right here. It led to a lot of public works being built. The Brooklyn Navy Yard, which is up in, you know, New York City, was, of course, actually constructed from that money, of course, that the government gave for that. They also built a lot of houses for people as well, because there was kind of a shortage of houses, especially from the 1930s up to the 1940s. Until like, I think, really after World War II, more or less. It created a lot of temporary unemployment. That's one of the main goals of what the Reconstruction Finance Corporation was mostly trying to do, And that's something you're going to see later, that under the New Deal, under Franklin D. Roosevelt, they do the kind of same thing as well, granting all these temporary work to people, put people to work, give them money in general. Some people think, though, they made a mistake with something, which was back in 1930. And that was in 1930, the Congress decided that, hey, one of the things that probably caused the Great Depression was tariffs. They're too low. Yeah, the tariffs were too low because remember they had kind of taken that away or whatever. But so what they did was 1930, they raised tariffs on a lot of imported goods. Like over 20,000 different goods imported to the country were actually, they raised extreme tariffs on them, protectionist tariffs, if you want to call it that. And of course, they say it caused like other countries to do the same thing. Like in Europe and other places, they did the same thing. They raised their tariffs also as well. And so what happened was they believed that actual higher tariffs may have helped to worsen the Great Depression and make things worse more than it should. So that's the only bad thing about that. Now, Hoover also had this other thing that happened. You may have heard about this story, which happened in 1932, which was the so-called bonus marchers that came to Washington. Kind of explain what that was about a little bit. It kind of scarred his chances of being reelected in 1932. It's called the Bonus Expeditionary Force. They arrived in the summer of 1932. Who were these men? They were basically World War I veterans that apparently in 1924, they had been awarded these life insurance policies. The only thing was they wouldn't be able to redeem them until 1945. So much, much later, like almost 20 years where you can get them, the money for it. But because of the Great Depression and the fact that the economy was so bad, they said, hey, we want part of it right now, like early payments, not the whole thing, but maybe part of it, basically. And of course, what happened was Herbert Hoover, President Hoover, decided that he's not going to do that. I'm not going to pay you. I'm not going to give the money to him. And so what happened was the bonus marchers, they something like 20,000 or more of them, decided they were going to wreck shanty towns and wait it out to see if maybe they could negotiate to get the money. And so in Washington, D.C., and on the outskirts, I guess, they formed all these shanty towns everywhere. And so this went on for like several weeks, by the way. And eventually what happened was Hoover decided basically that he'd had enough of basically these you know, veterans. And so what he did was he sent in the U.S. Army to take care of it, believe it or not. It's kind of one of the worst things ever in American history. I think you ever hear about this. And anyway, what happened was Hoover sent in Douglas MacArthur. You remember him? He's a famous general, of course, that fights in World War II against the Japanese. He was actually sent in with tanks and so on and soldiers. Also involved, you know who's also involved? Eisenhower. Dwight Eisenhower is involved in it. And I think they say George Patton, too. I think participated also, who were under MacArthur. And they broke it up. Used a lot of tear gas. They torched all the shanty towns. They burned them down. And over 100 people were actually injured in this incident. And I think only two babies died. Supposedly they got smothered to death because of all the smoke and all that was there with it. But the whole thing was like an embarrassment for Herbert Hoover. They think it really hurt his chances of being reelected in 1932. So that's one thing about it. You know, it's pretty much, and I think it was a joke later that they said about the difference between Herbert Hoover and what is Franklin D. Roosevelt. And the joke was that Hoover sent in the army and FDR sent his wife to talk to, you know, the actual bonus marchers. So Eleanor Roosevelt or something like went to talk to him or something, supposedly. So that really kind of leads into eventually what is the 1932, you know, presidential election that comes in. Which, of course, FDR will be eventually elected president of the United States. Here's kind of also kind of a picture of the 1932 election, which is right here. And, of course, it pitted two men, of course, against each other. Of course, what happened was in 1932, the Republicans decided that basically they were going to renominate Herbert Hoover, who ran on these ideas. He ran on just trying to balance the budget. He wanted to keep the high tariffs, of course, like they're talking about. I think the Democrats were talking about getting rid of the tariffs because they're too high. In prohibition, of course, is another issue. But Hoover doesn't really talk much else about trying to alleviate the problems of the Great Depression. He kind of seems oblivious about how bad things are really in the country. And then the Democrats, like I said, nominate Franklin D. Roosevelt, who I talked about, who, of course, was the governor of New York, a reformer, who, by the way, suffered from polio. If you know about this, my mother suffered from polio when she was young. And, of course, if you know about Franklin D. Roosevelt, he was paralyzed. He had to basically live in a wheelchair, ride around in a wheelchair, couldn't stand up. He campaigned on a totally different program. He campaigned on criticizing, Hoover's administration, the fact that they hadn't really been successful in trying to alleviate the problems of the Great Depression. He even came up with his own program ideas to basically save, the country, which were later called the New Deal. So they're called New Deal programs. His New Deal programs were ideas to reform not just, the economy, but the government, agriculture. He wanted to also regulate the stock market as well. He also promised to end prohibition as well, which, of course, they would do. And a lot of his ideas are famous later. I think they kind of joke about it, that they're kind of like the so-called alphabet soup type laws or programs that comes out later. That's part of the so-called New Deal. His ideas would help to kind of try to put people back to work. They would have like all these public works administrations that they would create that they kind of talked about a little bit in that video at the beginning of the lecture, like the WPA, probably the most famous, PWA, TVA, CCC, and all these different ones. And it didn't really end the Great Depression, but they think it helped to alleviate it a little and make it not so bad, by the time World War II did break out, more or less. But you can see from this, looking at this electoral map of the United States, that the election was a landslide. You can see that. You can see it like that, basically. I'll blow it up right here. But FDR got 472 electoral votes compared to Hoover, who only got, by the way, 59 in comparison. So he got clobbered. FDR, Franklin D. Roosevelt, will go on to basically, if you know about it, be elected four times as president of the United States, almost served, what could have been four terms. Before they obviously banned that. You only have now two terms now, of course. We'll get to it later, but he's going to get inaugurated in March of 1933. And, of course, he'll kind of set in motion like the program of the New Deal that will try to, alleviate the problems, like I said, of the Great Depression. Here you go, right here's another one. So yeah, he won 42 states, you can see in the landslide, to kind of give you an idea of some of the idea how good he did. Only president to be elected four times. He developed advisors known as the Brain Trust. So he brought in a lot of people that were more intelligent, maybe try to run the state, intellectuals from different universities, things like that in the country. So Roosevelt, winner in the landslide, you can see there. With that newspaper clipping, of course, on the right. It takes a while, though. You can see it ran on a slogan, too, by the way. Happy days are here again, famous slogan. But, yeah, even up to 1932, it's still kind of an issue. It takes a long time for all these different changes in the New Deal to have any effect at all. They still have 25% unemployment in 1932, even when he ran for re-election. More or less. So it's a struggle, though, the first few years, even after FDR came in. Now, FDR, of course, would come in, and they talk about the beginning of Franklin D. Roosevelt's administration and starting in 1933 as being called the so-called, they call it usually the so-called 100 days. And it's during that time when they begin to create a lot of programs like that are part of the New Deal, which were based on a lot of what they call pump priming. In fact, like I said, under Hoover, you know, where they basically borrowed a lot of money and tried to inject it into the economy. You know about FDR. FDR gave a famous speech. He's got different speeches. I think he's got two speeches that are considered his two most famous. The other one is the Pearl Harbor speech. You know, he gave December 8th, 1941. But the other one he gave was on March 4th, 1933. When he, you know, got elected in 1932, first time there. That's in his famous speech where he made that famous statement that the only thing they have to fear is fear itself. I'll kind of read the whole thing to you, but he said that this is preeminently the time to speak the truth, the whole truth, frankly and boldly, nor need we shrink from honestly facing conditions in our country today. This great nation will endure as it has endured, will revive and will prosper. So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself, nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed efforts to convert retreat into advance. In that short time, you know, he's going to try to, you know, create a lot of these New Deal programs, which can alleviate them. And the New Deal programs were, by the way, based on what they call the three R's, which you may have heard about this, which they are relief, recovery, and reform. So there are different things it was for the government, like I said, the economy, reforms in banking, reforms in the stock market, in agriculture, and things like that. Like I said, again, they are called sometimes the alphabet soup programs or alphabet soup laws, because a lot of them were based off of acts or laws that were passed by the U.S. Congress. One of the first things that they would create, by the way, was reforms in the banking industry. There you go. There's a slide right there about that. You got that, the so-called Emergency Banking Relief Act that was created in 1933. What it did was it did a bunch of things. First of all, they declared a banking holiday. You can see there where they closed all the banks. They decided basically which banks that they could save. They were still good. So that eliminated a lot of banks. They were kind of bad banks and so on. That's the first thing it did, more or less, with that. Then the other thing it did, too, was it created this corporation you may have heard of, which was called the FDIC, which is the Federal Deposit Insurance Company. And what that did was it basically it insured people's bank accounts up to a certain amount, which, by the way, in 1933 was $2,500. It was the most that they would insure in a bank account. Now it's $250,000 that you can see. Why do they do this? The reason why they did this was because they were trying to get people to have more confidence in putting money in the banks. Because a lot of people would not do that. They would take their money and they would put it like under their mattress. They would bury it in tin cans. Yeah, they put it in their shoes. There's a famous story where my uncle told the story to me that he did himself. God bless his soul. He's passed away a few years ago. But he had a story where he told me where he had put some money in his boots. His wife apparently thought, oh, those old boots, I'll throw them away. She threw them away. So they had to go to the dump, try to find the money, his shoes, never could find them. So yeah, that case where people would do that, put money in their shoes or somewhere and lose it. That was the reason why they did that too, to give people confidence and that they wouldn't get robbed by the banks. Because a lot of people didn't trust the banks, especially the poor people, you know, and all that. That's why I like John Dillinger and Bonnie and Clyde, you know, because they thought they were, you know, robbing everybody blind. They're taking everybody's houses too, like foreclosing on and all that. All right. Also, let me talk about some other things, of course, that happened. Of course, early in the you study about the the New Deal, one of the first big programs they came out with, which was very famous, that put people to work, was the Public Works Administration, so-called PWA, as they called it, which was formed, you can see, created in June of 1933. It was created, obviously, to provide jobs for people because you had so much unemployment throughout the country and all that. So they mostly, what the PWA did was it created primarily a bunch of these things, large-scale public works construction. So that's primarily what they did the most. They built different dams throughout the United States, bridges, hospitals, warships, hospitals. So I got it twice for some reason, hospitals. But, oh, schools, a lot of schools. That's one thing they're known for, building a lot of schools, of course, across, I think, like some like 500-600 schools were built by the PWA at one point. It was, by the way, run by the Secretary of Interior, Harold Ikes, and they spent something like $7 billion in the United States constructing all these different projects throughout the U.S. I'll give you some examples of some things they built. They built like Hoover Dam, helped finish it, Hoover Dam, Grand Coulee Dam, which is up in the Northwest in Washington, the Lincoln Tunnel, New York City area. They built over something like 600 schools were built. They built a lot of courthouses throughout the United States. A lot of Capitol buildings were also built with money from the PWA. Not sure about the Louisiana State Capitol, but some money for that may have been built for that too, also as well. Later they also had this other thing they also created too, which you may have heard about. Trying to think if I have a slide on that one or not, which is called the WPA, which is kind of similar to it, which is the Works Progress Administration. WPA is kind of similar, but it was mostly created to employ people, like millions of people, to put them to work building mostly public works throughout the United States. And they did all kinds of things. It was actually created later in 1935. And it was actually, they built all kinds of things too. They built a lot of roads. I think Route 66, I think, may have been built with it partially from that as an example. All kinds of buildings, dams, especially on the Tennessee River with the TVA project that was, big in the New Deal era as well. Harry Hopkins was the guy that ran the WPA, who was the Secretary of Commerce. You can see they employed at one point close to 8 million people in the United States. They're also famous for employing artists, which is true about that. I don't know if you go in some buildings, like say at LSU as an example, Louisiana State University, they have some, I think in the history department, I know they've got like some murals on the wall. They were done by these artists. They were hired by the WPA. And it was part of a program that was called the Federal Project Number One, where they employed actors, artists, musicians to employ people throughout the United States. So all kinds of things like that were done in the United States to employ people. Then they created the CCC, which they talked about in a little short video at the beginning, 1933. And the CCC was this government program, which obviously offered work for unemployed young men in the country, mostly from the age of 17 to 25 or 18 to 25, somewhere around that age, roughly. And they did all kinds of things you can see. They would obviously plant trees in forests, something that they're kind of known for. Also prevent forest fires, you can see there. Drinking water reservoirs, you can see there. Also other things, they would also clear swamps. They built small dams. They built public parks. I don't know if you've ever been to Kisatchie National Park, which is up in the kind of around Alexandria. Well, the CCC built that. If you know that park, that's where Kisatchie, it's kind of like a little hilly area up in there, Louisiana. You might want to go see one day. But yeah, they did construct that park as an example right there. Yeah, maybe over 3 million men may have actually been employed at one point with this. And they actually paid them something like what would be equivalent to like $30 per month. you know, at the time, which I think is equivalent to, like, I want to say $500-$600 a month now. Not much, but it was a way to, you know, get money to their family and all of that. And so, yeah, they had their own shelter, clothing, and food. It was almost like being in the military, really, the CCC, the way it was. And a lot of the money would be, they would be given to them to give to their families, was the whole point of it. Eventually, they closed it in 1942. They got rid of the CCC because of World War II. But a lot of the men that were in the CCC ended up in the military during the war. They're kind of already used to that kind of life, you know, more or less. So, yeah, civilian conservation corps, of course. They built a lot of forests. One thing they're kind of doing, plant trees and things like that in the United States. They also have the National Youth Administration as well, which I wanted to talk about today, which was kind of something that's around as well. What was that? That was a means to employ students that are in school, like high school primarily, where they were paid wages that would actually go to help their families. And so this was actually geared towards different peoples, black and white, more or less, throughout the United States. It aided thousands of people. I don't know the exact number. I've got 400-some thousand students that may have been aided with this program throughout the United States. But it was obviously, you can see there, it was created to keep people off the streets, keep people having jobs, and also the school, keep them in school, you know, that kind of thing, primarily. And so that was something that was geared towards, like, the youth in the country, more or less. So anyway, that NYA was another New Deal program that was also famous as well. We have to talk about the farmers. Don't forget about them. You know, the farmers, of course, also were aided too during the Great Depression. They had, of course, different things they had. They had the Farm Credit Administration was actually created by the FDR's administration in 1933. What did that do? It created this administration that would basically allow farmers to obtain cheap loans to basically keep their farmland or keep their house. And so they would offer, like, really, really cheap rates so that they could basically get, you know, they want to buy a place, but mostly I think it was for just them to keep or maybe to remortgage, I guess, their place. Yeah, interest rates were as low as 2.5% interest, which is pretty good. You know, that would be good today. You get 2.5 interest. And look at that, up to 50-year terms. I think now you can get up to like 30 years now, but 50 years. That's amazing. So they have that as an example to help out the farmers. There was this one thing that was kind of controversial that they talk about. Of course, there's the they had that too. I forgot about that. The Homeowners Loan Corporation was another one. There's like just all kinds of these different programs that were created during the New Deal that was around. Yeah, that one too. The Homeowners Loan Corporation, that was basically a type of corporation founded by FDR in Congress in 1933. What it did was it allowed homeowners to borrow money from this agency at low interest rates. So it's kind of like one for homeowners instead of farmers, basically. And it was mostly done to prevent, you know, their homes from being foreclosed on. And so, yeah, they could basically get really low interest rates as well, just like the farmers could, you know, as low as close to probably 2% as well. The only thing that's bad about the HOLC was that it basically is the one that created all the racial segregation that you see in neighborhoods today, what we call redlining. But you're a redlining, what that is, where basically banks wouldn't give money to certain peoples that were either poor or minority. And so you get this deal where neighborhoods are divided by segregation. Say black versus white, et cetera, Hispanic, whatever. And so that's one of the bad things about that, about what happened with the HOLC. They did have also something else I did want to mention too about the same time Congress had also, they have also, I forget about the Federal Housing Administration. I forget about that, but that was also created in 1933 as well in the New Deal. That's still around, the FHA, which the FHA, you can see, encouraged banks to lend money to homeowners. Like if they wanted to repair their house or they want to build a new house. And so they would offer like cheaper rates, like interest rates in general. And so, yeah, if you're building your first house, you know, you can get like an FHA loan, which is a lot cheaper. I don't think I ever did that when I bought my first home, in my second house now. But that's something that people do, of course, today a lot as well. So all these are different programs, you know, that were developed by pretty much, you know, under the New Deal, especially the first New Deal, I think, that came in initially. I wanted to find that other one, but I could find it somewhere. I don't know where it is, but there's one about the farmers that they had. I don't know. I can't seem to find it for some reason. But they did have this other one they had, I wanted to mention about, that the farmers had, that's very famous, which was kind of controversial. It was called the Agricultural Adjustment Act of 1933, or also called the first one. There's like two of them. There's one in 38, the 1938 Agricultural Adjustment Act. And that first one, what it did was it basically was an attempt by Congress to regulate agriculture because they believed that one of the causes of the Great Depression was overproduction of growing crops. There's too many crops out there. And so what they tried to do, if you know about it, it was like the first case where they gave the farmers subsidies. And one of the things they would do was they pay the farmers to not grow crops, not the whole you know, farm or whatever. But they would say, hey, you would only basically grow half of it, or you would take a fourth out of, you know, and not grow a fourth of your crop, basically, in exchange for subsidies. And the only thing about that was it was kind of controversial because of the fact that it didn't really work. It didn't really help to really, you know, alleviate the economy or anything. And then people also heavily criticized it because of the fact that it led to food shortages, you know, people being hungry because they're not growing as much crops. So eventually it was declared unconstitutional, by the way, in 1936 by the court case United States versus Butler. And it basically said that it was illegal because of the fact that agriculture can only be regulated by the states. It's like state power, 10th Amendment, I think it is. And so they eventually, that was eventually got taken out. But I think they have another one in 1938, maybe mentioned later, that they brought, which was kind of similar to it, that they brought back, which basically replaced it, which was the 1938 second one, Agricultural Adjustment Act. Well, that'll be later when that'll be. I'll probably talk about it later, maybe. That was like in the second New Deal, which will be in the future. So, yeah, these were, you know, things that were kind of trying to alleviate the economy, but it really didn't. It took years for it to actually work, for some kind of, you know, alleviation, put people to work somewhat. But they don't really think that the Great Depression ends until World War II. World War II really will help to really alleviate things because of the war industry. They needed so much, you know, munitions, you know, planes being built, tanks being built, on things like that. They think it created an economic boom after World War II ended. So it kind of helped jumpstart it, they think, the New Deal, but it didn't solve really the problems, really, of the economic issues in the Great Depression. So I'm probably going to stop here for today. Later in the week on Thursday, I'll kind of continue. I'll talk about kind of like the second New Deal, which kind of FDR brings in a little later, like into like close to his second term. I'll also talk about the anti-New Dealers. You have all these people that don't like the New Deal. They don't think it's working right. Like Huey Long, you probably heard of him, and a few others that were against FDR. So I'll talk about him. We'll talk about Huey Long. He's from, you know, Louisiana. He's very famous. We know him, of course, here. We'll talk about him a lot. We'll talk about that and probably should have time to maybe get in even and start talking about possibly the workup to getting into World War II. Maybe talk about the rise of World War II if I have time overall. So that's it for today. If anybody has any other questions about this lecture, let me know on my, of course, my YouTube channel. Don't forget, I did have, of course, I was talking about that assignment y'all have got up. That's right now for y'all to work on. Make sure you get that done. Let's see, what was that? I think I was talking about the first exam, right? Is that what y'all are working on? I believe that's right. That assignment, that should be, of course, coming due. Or y'all did that already, I thought, one of those assignments. But basically, I'll send out announcements about what's due and all that this week. And so that's it for today. I'll see you, of course, again on Thursday. We'll continue talking about, of course, the Great Depression and all that. And that's it for today. So y'all take care, and I'll see you later.